Around 30 of the world's leading and rising triathletes will descend on Cebu this month for a battle royale of sorts, the biggest gathering ever of endurance runners in Ironman 70.3 Philippines. Now at the helm is Alaska's top guy, a triathlete himself, and an Endeavor entrepreneur, Fred Uytengsu. He joins us this morning from our Rockwell studio to talk sports and business and the business of sports. Good morning, Fred. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
So, Fred, at 57 years old, do you still wake up at 5 every morning to exercise and to put in 8 to 10 hours of training a week?
Well, I'm here in the studio, so I'm going to go work out afterwards today. But I still try and keep active.
Mm-hmm. Fred, you once described yourself when it comes to training as obsessive compulsive. I saw this in your previous interviews. I'm curious, how much of the athlete in you do you bring to the boardroom as head of Alaska Milk Corporation?
You know, I think I bring a lot of it because there are many attributes I've learned being an athlete growing up and then still an athlete today, being a triathlete, that it bring motivation, dedication, perseverance. All these are key attributes in the business world.
And I know you love to compete too.
I've been told I am competitive, yes.
So looking at the local dairy industry these days, what's the outlook like? Because I checked Nestle and Alaska Milk. Based on your monitor, Nestle Philippines actually holds the top spot in drinking milk products with a market share of about 50%. But Alaska, you lead the other dairy segments with a share of 70%, primarily driven by the condensed milk, cream, and coffee whiteners. What's the outlook like over the next 3 to 5 years?
I think the outlook for dairy in the Philippines is very robust. If you consider, we still have a fairly low consumption per capita. So as our economy continues to grow, as people become more affluent, food is usually the first beneficiary of that. We will see people continue to enter the dairy category to consume milk at least once a day. That still is not happening. So the future is very bright for dairy in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. Do you consider competition very tight in this industry?
Well, you know, anytime you compete against the world's largest food company, that is a daunting fact. And we also have some other competitors in the category as well. Snow Dairy is a very strong competitor. And competition is good. It's good for the industry. It's good for consumers. It brings out the best in you.
Mm-hmm. Fred, what seems to be the biggest challenge these days? Is it Forex? Could it be the tax reforms? Is it logistical infrastructure challenges?
I think there's quite a few challenges on the front. Yes, competition is key. You always want to endear yourself into what I call the hearts and the minds of consumers, and we want Alaska to be the first choice for consumers. You also have to look at global world prices of dairy. The Philippines is reliant on imported milk powder, and so if there is a fluctuation in the cost of skim milk powder around the world, that has an impact. At Alaska Milk, we've always been focused on being the leading providers of affordable nutrition. So we need to try and manage any price fluctuation against the consumer to make sure that milk is relevant to the Filipino. And that will continue to be a challenge. Logistics, obviously, in a country like the Philippines with 7,100 islands, is a challenge, and we need to be available at every distribution point to the consumer. So you hit it, you hit the nail on the head. You know, there are quite a few challenges, but we're certainly up to the challenge. I know competition is, and it's a matter of making sure that our brand continues to be the brand of choice for the millions of Filipino consumers.
And the foreign exchange, you've got the peso weaker against the dollar. Does it make this more difficult for Alaska because you import a lot of your supplies?
Absolutely. We have to index our cost of skim milk powder in U.S. dollars, and so we need to hedge against that. A weaker currency is not good for us, so continued deterioration would be a negative cost driver for us as a company and for the industry as a whole.
And do you think that dairy prices will go up locally here in the Philippines soon? Are you going to be passing on those added costs?
I think that that is a possibility. Every company will try and manage that. You want to minimize price increases to the consumer, but when absolutely necessary, we look at doing it very responsibly.
Mm-hmm. Fred, it's been 6 years since your family sold the controlling stake in Alaska for around $300 million. I know it's the past, but I'm just very curious, why was it sold in the first place?
Well, you know, we've always been approached over the years of whether or not we would sell. It started as a family business. I took it public in the 90s. And we grew the business to a very significant size. We reached a point whether we would go international ourselves, whether we would invite a local partner. And at that point in time, we found a company which, interestingly enough, was the same company that my father partnered with when he formed Alaska Milk in 1971. Mm-hmm. This is a company that we had shared values, shared mission. They are a dairy cooperative and the fifth largest dairy company in the world. And we felt that we could grow Alaska faster partnering with them. And eventually we decided to sell with the assumption they would continue with the same strategic goals and maintain the mission of Alaska Milk, which is to be the leading providers of affordable nutrition.
Mm-hmm. You know, in the Philippines, it's these businesses are seen in a very emotional way because a lot of the businesses here are run by families like yourselves. Is it safe to say that this decision to sell did not come with any emotional baggage?
Without a doubt. I think I had many sleepless nights when we were making that decision and when we arrived at it finally. You know, when it came time to signing the contract, I thought long and hard about it. And once we did the deal, then obviously we moved forward. I continued to stay and run the company for the next 5 years. I stepped down as the CEO at the end of last year, but I remain as chairman of the company and I still continue to advise the company and the team.
And Fred, what did you learn? What lessons did you learn or take away from this experience?
Well, first of all, you have to be perseverant. And this is common of every entrepreneur, that you will meet challenges. And you have to be relentless in your pursuit of achieving your goals. The other thing that I learned was teamwork is essential. I grew up as a competitive swimmer, and that's an individual sport, and you're reliant just on yourself. To run a successful business, you have to have a great team. And over the years, I learned that through teamwork, that we were able to achieve our goals. And building a team was of utmost importance to me. What was really gratifying for me personally is that I built a team that, to a greater extent, was with me for about 17 years. Some were longer, some a little bit less, but my management team was so tight-knit that we'd sit around in a meeting and we could finish each other's sentences. So we were very much aligned, that we thought alike, but yet we were not afraid to challenge one another. And I think that's very important. If you have an organization, especially a family business, where the patriarch or you become the son of the patriarch and everyone sits around and defers to you, then you're not going to get the best out of that organization. You need to create an environment that challenges everyone in a diplomatic but in a robust way so that you get the best out of the entire team.
You already mentioned teamwork. I was hoping to ask what synergies were able to form with a Dutch company, Friesland Campina, which bought the control stake. I mean, where is the Philippines' contribution to the bigger picture of Friesland Campina?
Well, you know, they are a huge, huge company, and so we're small relative to their size, but the Philippines consistently performs very well relative to their other business units around the world. In fact, this year, as an example, Alaska Milk is the fastest growing company within the Friesland Campina network. For a couple years in 2016, 2015, again, the best performing business unit in there. So we're looked at as an example of how family business has been able to be successful amidst a world of multinationals, and they learn from that. They learn from many of the entrepreneurial decisions that we have taken to be successful against global giants.
And of course, let's bring the conversation back to the endeavor. You're part of this network of high impact entrepreneurs. I understand this is your first time to become a mentor. What are you expecting from this experience?
Well, actually, I've probably spent the last 5 years or so mentoring in an informal basis. Mm-hmm. I'm a mentor for a young president's organization. I've mentored some of my daughters, my eldest daughter's friends who are in business, one who started Task Us here in the Philippines, which is a very successful BPO business. And I've reached a stage in my career where I really feel it's important to give back. And I was the beneficiary of being mentored in my early years. I really see the importance of giving back to the next generation, helping them, sharing some of my experiences. Hopefully over the years I've acquired a little bit of wisdom and trying to avoid some of the mistakes I may have made and giving them that information earlier in their development stage.
Fred, one mistake that you made that you want the future generations or your mentees to avoid?
Well, I think the biggest issue that I see in the next generation, and the millennials get a bad rap for this, is that, you know, they want instant gratification. And so what I try and tell them is that you just need to keep your head down. You need to persevere. You need to maintain that work ethic. I mean, people look at the Mark Zuckerbergs of this world and they think it's instant success. I think what they don't realize is the hour upon hour that he puts in, day out, week in, week out, to be successful. So I try and inculcate that a strong work ethic, which is something my father inculcated in me, is vital to the success. There are no shortcuts to success in business or in anything in life for that matter.
No shortcuts indeed. And spoken like a true sportsman. Thank you very much, Fred, for joining us this morning. It was good talking to you.